so much stronger. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, oh, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your
and the sin.
to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And oh, what a Savior! Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah! Christ is
centering prayer this morning. Let's say it together. Father, overwhelm us with your love so that we live from the beauty of being your children. Jesus, deepen our love for you and teach us to love each other and all people the same way you love us. Spirit, equip us and shape us as a sent people who partner with you. Amen. You can
I'm with you. I'll go anywhere, anywhere you call me to, as long as I'm with you. As long as I'm with you. You're the adventure of a lifetime, Jesus. Take my heart and make it wild. You are the thrill my soul is seeking, Jesus. Grace has no horizon line. Your grace has no horizon line. And I'll go anywhere, anywhere. my soul. There is no map for where your wild heart takes us. We're running into the unknown, yeah, yeah. We're running into the unknown. I'll go anywhere, anywhere at all, as long as I'm
you.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to New Garden this morning. I hope you enjoyed the slideshow, got to see a little bit of the scenes from VBS. We talked about following Jesus. And so we talked about how Jesus has already done what Jesus needs to do, and we just need to follow, and Jesus is with us in that. And so that was a really good week at VBS this year. So if you came out, it was fun to see you, and it was fun. If you want to come next year, please make plans to do that. It was a really, really great week. A lot has happened in the last month. I've been to 3 camps and a VBS, so I'm feeling pretty just happy to be here this morning and see you all. I've survived that. There's a lot of things coming up that we can be looking forward to. July 20th, we have a mobile food pantry here on Saturday. That's going to be a really fun thing and a really good thing, a thing that I have enjoyed over my time as a part of this group, that we have committed to doing this, to serving in this way. So that's really exciting. And then also in July, we're going to have guests here one Sunday from NICE, which is the Nashville Immigrant Center for Empowerment. And the next week from the Tennessee Prison Outreach Ministry. And so there's going to be opportunity in July to learn more about how you can get involved in different ways, in a way that works for you, in a way that you're able to serve. And so I'm excited about that coming up in July as well. I'm really happy that you're here. Our kids are going to go out that door during this next song. Today we're starting a new series. Josh is going to talk more about that. We're talking about Flannelgraph faves, some of our stories that we learned as a kid. Let's take a look at them again now and see what we can glean and learn, what God might be trying to tell us through Scripture in a way that maybe we haven't thought of before. So I'm really excited about that. I'm glad that you're here. I'll let our worship team continue to lead us in worship. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you that we're here. Thank you that we have a place that's not as hot as outside that we can be this morning. God, I just ask that you will send your Spirit in here today, God, that we might hear a message from you. God, thank you for this place that we get to be, this group of people that we get to be with every week. Thank you for the ways that you continue to show up and transform us, even in ways that we might not be recognizing yet. God, you are good. Thank you for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we continue worship.
My soul, I live for. is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give you praise. All is in you. Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake. Lord, have your I never wanna leave.
As your people, as your children, God, we pray that you open our hearts and our minds to hear your word and your message for us this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. I'll be ready in a minute. All right. Good to see everybody this morning. I don't know about you, but I loved walking into Bible class seeing the flannel graph up. And some of y'all may have used a flannel graph in teaching situations, and it was always fun because you knew it was going to be a little different, right? Because they were going to move stuff. It's this original stop animation stuff, right? Like they would move them around. You teach a little bit and you take some off. My dad was the preacher, so I was always there early. So if I'd go into class and nobody else was in there, I might take something off. The teacher would be looking for it later on. I'd put something extra on there just to keep everybody on their toes. When I would go in and I would see specific things on the board, I knew what the lesson was about, right? I knew if I saw the lions that we were going to talk about what? Daniel and lion's den. If I saw the whale or the fish with Jonah inside of it, right? Or this is Esther. You probably can't tell because I took her out of context. I don't have the rest of her story up here, right? But I knew going in what the story was going to be about. But the older I got and the more classes that I went to and the more time I spent, the more I knew what the moral of the story was going to be, right? The more I knew what the theme or what the takeaway was supposed to be whenever I went in and I saw whatever it was that was on the flannel that morning, I knew what the answer was. And I guess that's good in a way, but it also started to inhibit my interaction with the text. And I don't know if you were in that situation too, and maybe it happened to us in a way that we didn't really understand, but what it did was it caused us to already come with ideas about what the lessons were going to be about, what the answers were going to be about, and so what did we stop doing? We stopped learning. We stopped interacting with the Bible in a real and vibrant way. We stopped expecting, and at that age we wouldn't really put it in this terms, but we stopped going to class expecting to meet God. We stopped going to the text expecting to meet God because we had it all figured out, right? And as long as you put the right notes up there, we could figure out what the song was going to be, if you like that analogy better. And so the problem was that we got into a situation, and I got into a situation where when I would go to the text, I would go to the text to not necessarily to learn, but to maybe to solidify what I already knew. To beef up what I already had an idea in my mind was going to be about. And so the Bible started to become something a little too familiar, I think, to all of us. I think that's the danger of certain repetitions that we get into. And it really was bad because we would be warned that if there's anything new that ever came up, or if there's anything that wasn't what we'd always talked about and what we'd always heard, we would always be taught to say, well, we better stay away from that, right? That might be evil. That might be Satan trying to get in. And we don't want to let anything new in, right? We don't want to let Satan in the door because no telling what will happen. And unfortunately, that's baggage that we've all carried into adulthood. That's baggage that we've carried with us as we've gone and grown up. And as we've made our walk with God, going to the text and reading the text, reading the Bible is not something that's really something that we do. We've lost our vision. We've lost our vision for nuance. And text as it comes to us that we didn't, in ways that we don't expect it to. Like, no longer do we go and expect to be amazed, or no longer do we go and expect to be awestruck by reading the text. So what I love about our worship is there's constantly new songs being put together, and I am so thankful that God has gifted people to write songs and to invoke things that have been around for thousands of years and bring it back to the forefront and bring it back to the top of our mind. I'm thankful that He gives people the ability to get up and lead us and draw us to the throne and be part of that, because we have lost some of that in our walk with God. The Bible is an amazing gift, but it's got to the point where we don't even carry it anymore, right? Everybody in here probably that is old enough has a phone and has a Bible on that phone. We don't even carry the Bible anymore, right? We don't have that anymore. And it's become so commonplace that it's almost like we know everything, but at the same time, when we look at the Bible, we approach the Bible has to be something that we come to that we can know. And we can interact with God, but then we also understand that the Bible is something, and God's Word, and God alive through His Word and through the Spirit is something that we can never fully know either, that we can never fully ingest. And so every time we come, we get to interact with Him through His Word. We get to interact with each other as we sit around and we talk about the Bible, we talk about the lessons, we talk about things. The Bible is not a static revelation of God. It's alive. And God is constantly talking to us and interacting with us if we will just go with Him where He leads us. And so how do we get a little bit past the Flannelgraph? And we're going to get to our story this morning. Our story this morning is in Genesis 4, Cain and Abel. But before we get there, I want to talk a little bit how we can get past this trap we have of knowing everything already and thinking we know everything already. And there's nothing new for us to come in contact with, because I think it's of vital importance that every time that we go to the text, every time that we go to the Bible, that we expect to meet God, that if we show up, that He shows up. And maybe it's a better way to say it, that He's always going to show up and that we need to show up to Him and with Him. And let Him speak to us and let Him work inside of our lives. We need to go expecting to be fed, expecting to be encouraged, expecting to be uplifted, and expected to be challenged. See, that's the real part, is the challenges that come through the Bible to us. And so a way forward for us as we think about it, we've got some cards. Michael's going to pass out some cards that are kind of linked to this series. Give us a way to think about as we approach the text. And it's a series of four steps. We're going to talk about it here for a few minutes. And this came through kind of our teaching team. And Jeff Brown brought this to us. And they started this week at Main Campus as well. But this is a process that we can use not just for this series, but it's a process that we can use every time we approach the Bible. Every time we go to the Bible. You don't have a system for when you go to the Bible of listening to God and hearing God. Let's create something to make that happen. Let's create that some way that we can let that be a part of who we are and how we walk, all right? And so there's four steps, pretty simple. We're just going to talk about them in just a minute. Start everything with prayer. I don't think this is too much to say, too much to ask, too much to ever emphasize. We start everything with prayer and we say, hey, God, show up. Show us something. Help us to be interact today. Help us to be where you need us to be. Reveal to us what you want us to see. I don't know about you, but there's times I read texts I've seen over there. And the one we're going to talk about this morning, after I studied and I watched some videos, I did some stuff on this. There were some points about this that I'm going to talk about this morning that I had never considered in the Cain and Abel story. It's all about listening to God and letting God talk to us. And the second thing is to savor it. Now, that's a word we don't necessarily use outside the kitchen, right? But that means let's just slow down. Let's just slow down and sit with God and His Word for a minute. Let's slow down and just let it permeate and be around us and take notice. Look at details, make connections, ask questions. When you sit down and study your Bible, if you have an app note on your phone, open it up and write down questions, write down thoughts. If you have a notebook or a pen, carry it with you and always write down things, because in a very real way, that is the Spirit prompting you to go deeper. When you ask questions, you think about it, and you prod and you move forward. And some of the best questions we can ask is, how do we see God in these texts? What do we learn about God? And an even better question is, why does it matter? Why does it matter that we learn new things? Why does it matter God reveals himself to us in different ways? And the last thing is, how do we respond? Right? How do we respond to what God has spoken to us today? If it's something that causes us to pause and rethink where we are headed in life, or rethink the people we have in our lives, or rethink those type of things, what has been revealed to us asking of us? And are we strong enough as people to change courses when we need to change courses? That's the real thing, right? Are we strong enough as people, and this is kind of a, doesn't make sense, are we strong enough to be humble enough to change when we need to change? And go a different way? And when we talk about being stuck in something, we want to move a different direction, we got to know where we are, we got to know where we're going, we got to have a plan to get there, and this is a plan to get somewhere else. Next week, Michael's going to talk to us from Genesis chapter 22 about the testing of Abraham and Isaac. And I encourage you to use this in Genesis 22 this week as you kind of work through it and think about and process, write down, go through this. And I want to hear from you this week, right? This is the shepherd's encouraging number. And if something comes up while you're working through this week and you have a thought or something like that, text this. I get it. I see it. I'll respond to it. Something hits you just right. Something rises to the top. God's pushing something out. Bring it to us. And Michael will see it too. And maybe it'll make it into the sermon next week. No promises, but maybe it'll make it into the sermon next week. So with all that in mind, right? I still got 20 minutes. With all that in mind, let's get into Genesis 4, okay? Genesis 4. Adam made love to his wife Eve, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain, and she said, "With the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man." Later, she gave birth to his son, to his brother, Abel. Now, Abel kept flocks, and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord, and Abel also brought an offering, fat portions, and from some of the firstborn of his flock. And the Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at the door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it." Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out into the field." While they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where's your brother Abel?" "I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper?" And the Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you're under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened up its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. And you, when you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops to you. You will be a restless wanderer on the earth." But Cain said to the Lord, a little ironic here, right? "My punishment is too much. It's more than I can bear. Today you drive me to the land. I'll be hidden from your presence. I'll be a restless wanderer on the earth. And whoever finds me will kill me." But the Lord said to him, "Not so. Anyone who kills Cain will suffer vengeance seven times over." Then the Lord put his mark on Cain so that no one who found him would kill him. So Cain went out from the Lord's presence and lived in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Very familiar passage to us, isn't it? Very familiar. We know who did right. We know who did wrong. We know what the lesson is for us. We know how it should have gone. Is that all there is? Just do better. Don't kill somebody. Make the right offering. In this passage, and I didn't read the whole passage of chapter 4, there's four birth narratives. The first one is when Adam and Eve have Cain and Abel. And then there's the one where Cain and his wife have a baby named Enoch. And then the next one is when Adam and Eve have Seth. And then the last one is when Seth and his wife have Enosh. Now, I want to focus on the Adam and Eve ones for just a minute. There's this interesting wordplay that goes on throughout this text, right? And Adam, and when they name their kids, when Eve names Cain, Cain's name translates roughly to blacksmith or creator, if you will, because the letters in his word, in his name, are the same letters that are in the words creator, to create, or creator. Now, Abel, again, a little bit of wordplay here, his name means vapor or mist. Almost indicative of how his life went and how quickly it was taken from him. The language that Eve uses there in the birth narrative of the first one is really problematic, because she says, with the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man. And she say, look at what God and I did. God and I made this. And if you hear it right, you'll hear echoes of Moses standing at the rock after God says, hey, Moses, strike that rock and water come from it. Moses smacks that rock and he says, God and I had to bring water from this rock for you. The with in this passage here is the same with the Hebrew word that you'll find in the Ten Commandments when God says, do not make any graven image that will sit with me. And if you hear it right, you hear Eve elevating herself to the status of God, which not status, but on the same plane with God, right? She's saying, God and I created this. And by naming him Cain, she gives herself quite a bit of pat on the back, and that creative power that she had. Oh, and God too, right? God did that too. Here's an important note as we read the book of Genesis. Every generation follows this pattern. The woman or the couple that desires to have children work either through ambition or through some type of questionable motive to create children. And you know what happens whenever they do that? There's always conflict. There's always conflict in the generation to come and the kids that they created. And here's a couple examples. Abraham and Sarah. Man, did that work out well for Isaac and Ishmael? Or what about Isaac and Rebekah and the mess with Jacob and Esau? Or then we get in the story of Jacob and Rachel and Jacob and Leah and Jacob and the two handmaidens and Joseph and all of his brothers and the mess that was from that. And you see a pattern that flows through there that whenever we as humanity seek to be the creators of our own destiny, when God told Abraham and Sarah, said, you will have children, you'll have more kids than your descendants will be like the stars in the sky. And they set about trying to figure it out on their own. You see, we mess it up, and we don't just mess it up for us. We mess it up for the next generation. We mess it up for those who come after us who have to clean up our mess. And so then if we jump down to the end of the passage, the third birth narrative, where Eve again, Adam and Eve conceive, and then Eve gives birth to Seth, the conversation from Eve or the statement from Eve is very different. After the mess they just went through, after she lost a son, he said, God has granted me another child in the place of Abel. Not a hint of her power, not a hint of her creative ability. She said, God has done this. God has given this to us. And the text, if we just spend time listening at it, is going to be echoes of really bad decision making and echoes of things that we shouldn't be doing and shouldn't be going after. And it's not whether we see them, because we see them all the time. We've been seeing them since we were in grade school. It's whether we listen to them and we allow them to permeate who we are and help us make better decisions. Let God help us make better decisions. And so then we get over into the next section where we have the offerings made, right, from Abel and Cain. Now, Abel was a shepherd and Cain was a farmer. He worked the soil. Now, in my mind, and I'm neither one of those people, right? But in my mind, a farmer and a shepherd both work where? Out of town, right? But the reality is, in that day and time, farmers were city builders. The farm where the food was raised, that's where they built the cities around. And shepherds worked out in the fields and worked out away from everybody in a rural setting. And so farmers were in a very urban area, known as city builders. Now, as we look at Scripture again, who does God favor of those two people, whether it be the shepherds or the farmers? Well, Abel was a shepherd. Abraham was a shepherd. Moses was a shepherd. David was a shepherd. The whole Israelite nation were shepherds. Now we contrast that to city builders or farmers, and we get Cain, who built the first city. We get Nimrod. Here's extra points if you know which city Nimrod built. Anybody? Nimrod built Babel. Pharaoh was a city builder. And then you get to Lot, or you find Lot. And Lot maybe didn't build cities, but where did he choose to live? He chose to live in the cities, right? Opposite of Abraham. And so the image that is constructed for us through Genesis, at the very least, is that city builders become this image of people who are trying to build their own Eden. They're trying to build their cities. They're trying to build this fortification. And we contrast that against shepherds who are out in the wilderness. You know what they have to rely on? They have to rely on for water and food and everything. The only thing they have to rely on is God. And so you have this contrast between those who are trying to build their own Eden and those that are trying to build their own way, and you have those who are trusting fully and relying fully on God. And so when we look at the offerings that are made, if we get past what the offerings are made, what we see is God not necessarily not loving one and loving the other so much as He's affirming a way of life that's going to be fully reliant on Him. He's affirming a lifestyle that is going to be about Him, not about me making my greatness. So then you have the offerings again. And as I've read this as a child, I came back and read it again. I spent some time in commentaries. I was amazed at just how many misconceptions I had that I brought to the text, right? Cain offered fruit offerings. If you read Exodus, Deuteronomy, and Leviticus, were fruit offerings acceptable? Yes, they were. Cereal, grain, all those things, all those offerings were acceptable. Cain brought an acceptable offering. But you look at Abel's and you see that Abel brought the choice part, the firstborn of his flock, the fat portions of his flock. And so what it tells us is there was more going on there. Maybe the intentionality of Abel was greater than the intentionality of Cain. You know, the animal offerings being firstborn was more costly. And the fruit, we're not really given a much idea about the fruit offering because we don't know that much. We just weren't given it, but we don't know if Cain brought the first fruits or if he brought the last fruits, if he brought the rotten stuff, if he brought the okay stuff. We don't know what he brought. But the text specifically says that Abel brought the good stuff. And we talk about offerings, we talk about giving, and I'm not trying to parlay this into that. This is not about giving, but we do need to understand that this is a touchy subject when we talk about this. You know, one of the childhood takeaways I got away from this was make sure that we give God His first and we give Him the best first because I don't want God to smite me, right? So I want to make sure I do the right thing on the front end. And I don't think it's a bad takeaway. I think it's problematic, though, because it's not just about money. It's not just about the amount of time that you volunteer or however ways that you see that you give within the world that you live in, that we live in. But it's about what are we willing to give? Are we willing to give what costs us the most? Are we willing to give what is most precious to us in order to honor God with what He has given us? You see, there's so many layers. Is God's, and I don't even want to call it rejection, God didn't reject Cain, God just accepted Abel. Was God's acceptance of Abel's, was it a disapproval of the types or all of that, or was it about what the intent and the substance was? Because Abel's indicated selectivity and indicated a lot of care. You see, God didn't reject Cain. And that's one of the takeaways from this story that I think we get, that God rejected Cain. That's what made him angry. But the text says that God looked on, and depending on which version you read, God looked on Abel's with love, but did not look on Cain's with love. God looked favorably upon Abel's, but did not look favorably upon Cain's. So whatever the issue is, right? As we work through this, as we navigate it, we all want to be the chosen one. We want to be the able, right? We want to be on the side of the story where God's accepted us. But what happens when you're the chosen one? What happened to Abel? It cost Abel his life. Having your sacrifice preferred, and this is one of those things that we don't talk about, right? But having your sacrifice preferred is often detrimental to your life. Abel, Joseph was preferred, and what happened to him? He ended up in a pit almost dead and ended up in slavery. Abraham was on the run. Jacob, talk about Jacob being preferred. He ran. Of course, he had a lot of baggage that he was carrying with him. David became the chosen king, and man, did it get bad for him quick. And not least of these is Jesus, the chosen one, ordained by God, sent by God. And what did humanity do to him? Humanity hung him on a cross. And so the next time that we think that we want the full approval of God, I'm not saying we don't, but I'm saying next time we go down that road and that's what we're all about, understand that if that's where we end up, then the road ahead will be bumpy. The road ahead may be difficult. And so then we get to Cain's response, right? And we need to pay attention again to the nuance of the text. Cain brought his offering first because it says, the text says, Cain brought his offering and then Abel brought his. Cain brought a suitable offering, yet God did not love or God did not favor his offering. And so I get it. I get Cain's anger here. I get Cain being a little upset because Cain came and made the offering and Abel was like, oh, I guess I better go do that too. And the struggle there, and as we look around in our own lives and we see people that we assume or that we feel are being blessed more than we're blessed, or God is looking after more than he's looking after us, and we get angry because why are they getting more than we are getting? Why is that church growing and we're not growing the way we think we should grow? Why is this happening and not that happening? Why is my best not good enough? And Cain fell into a trap that is pretty difficult. It's a trap that was fallen into a lot of times throughout scriptures. Cain fell into this trap where he felt like he was rejected by God forever. Like it was a one and done. Like he was on the outside looking in now. And this was not a rejection of Cain for all time. This was a rejection. It wasn't even a rejection. God just favored this one over that one. And the sentiment that even God said to him is, if you'll do better, if you'll do good, next time it'll be different. And so as we walk with God and we think that we've fallen short of God, we have to understand that failure isn't the final thing, right? We don't lose favor with God when we don't do good. We don't lose favor with God when we don't do the right thing. We don't lose favor with God when we end up in places we don't want to be. It's like we said, that line I brought from that song, my last lesson, on our best days we're children of God and on our worst days we're children of God. Failure isn't final. We're all going to fail. We're all going to stumble. Giving in to anger, that's final. But failure is not. Making rash decisions, doing things that you wouldn't normally do, that's failure. And sometimes that is final. And so what do we learn about God in our failures? We could go back and we could ask Adam and Eve a few chapters earlier, what does God do whenever we fail? Well, God banished them from the garden, but he also took care of them. They lost this plush existence that they had, but God still clothed them and took care of them and gave them jobs and had them things for them to do so that they would survive. And here again, as we look at Cain's story, even though Cain had fallen short and Cain had made a really, really bad thing, done a really bad thing, he comes to God and he says, God, this punishment is too great. And God says, no, you'll still be taken care of. Isn't it great that our God doesn't write our failures down and brings them back to our memory every day? Sometimes we do that, but God doesn't. And how we respond to those failures, that is the most important. Because God doesn't judge us on our failures. God judges us based on Jesus' work. The work of our Savior. That's what God judges us on. And so how do we respond to God in our failures? How do we respond to God when we fall off and we lose our path? There's that beautiful song that we sing that talks about our defender, great defender. And there's a line in there that says, all I did was worship, and all I did was praise, and all I did was sit still. Sometimes we're going to mess up so bad that we need just to stop and just sit. We need just to stop and stop trying to make it better, stop trying and stop making it worse, and just sit and accept God. Just sit and accept the love of God and the mercy of God and the grace of God that's poured out on us every day. And regardless of how good we do, whether God is smiling on our offerings or not smiling on our offerings, that we're still children of God in that moment. Whatever the path that we're on and the trip-ups we made, the things we fall into, the ways we walk away from God, regardless of what that looks like and how it is, we are still children of God, and we've never walked so far away from God that we can't get back. We can't get so far away from God that God's going to stop loving us. We can't get so far off track that God's going to not forgive us, that there's not going to be mercy, there's not going to be grace. So as we transition to our table time, right? I know this was a lot. I know there was a lot in this lesson this morning, a lot of things I don't normally do, texts and whatnot and that type of thing. And maybe today as you come to the text, the table, that you're happy I'm done speaking. I get that. Maybe that's one of these days for you. I hope that as we come today to the table, that we remember that regardless of what we do, that our God loves us anyway. Regardless of whether we offer our best or we do our best or whether we trip up or whether we're an A student, regardless of where we are on that path, that God still loves us and God's still taking care of us. I'm thankful that even when my offering isn't great, that my God is still great. I'm thankful that my actions and your actions and our decisions don't dictate whether God loves us today. It won't dictate whether God loves us tomorrow. That's not on us. That's for Him. I'm thankful that His love is forever, His acceptance of us is forever, and His grace is forever. And we get to gather around the table together and remember that as a family and pour our praise out to Him. Will you pray with me? God, for today, I am just so thankful that you're God and I'm not. I am thankful that when I fail, when we fail, when we trip up, that you're still loving us, you're still taking care of us, that we behave in a way that you help us behave in a way that honors that. As we gather around the table, may we love you more, serve you more, be humbly in your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Come, let's go to the table.
In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you and to your care alone. And I trust you, I don't need to understand. So make me your vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. With all you have given me, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. 'Cause where there is new wine, there is new power. There is new freedom, and the kingdom is here. I lay down my old flames to carry your new God today.
It's so interesting. Thank you, Josh, for sharing with us this morning. But it's so interesting just the way that we can read stories and how they hit us differently at different times. Like, I'm reading it, the story, and I'm thinking about how important it is that we go to God when we're dealing with disappointment instead of killing our brother or doing something rash, you know, like that. And it's just so interesting the way that God works. So I invite everybody, take some time this week, read some scripture. You can use the card. Next week, we'll be reading Genesis 22. We'll be talking about that story. So if that's something you want to do, I welcome it. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you for your goodness. God, thank you for the ways that you encourage us to deal with the disappointment around us in our life. Thank you for creating new wine out of us. When we are feeling crushed and pressed. God, thank you for being with us no matter where we are or what we do. God, you are good to us. Be with us this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.